reflection fluorescence microscopy, and we are very grateful that we can have Dr. Bugyi again here. We count her amongst the standard and faithful panelists team, and we are very grateful. Thank you again very much for coming and flourishing.
Thank you. Thank you for the kind introduction. First of all, I would like to the invitation and traditionally kind hospitality of the organizers, and it's really a pleasure for me to be here on the 5th anniversary of this summer school. So I would like to talk about fluorescence microscopy technique that uses the unique features of an analyst and field, and I'm sure that you had already kind of introduction from Professor Manoj. So this technique uses the unique features of an evanescent field that is generated upon total internal reflection. So a total internal reflection fluorescence microscopy, otherwise called as TURF, allows to selectively illuminate fluorophores which are very close to a surface, and it does not illuminate those ones which are in solution farther away from the surface. So what are the applications of this technique? So it's mostly applied in life sciences. It can be a useful technique in cell culture studies when you are interested in cell surface, cell extracellular matrix interactions, or even near or at within the plasma membrane. It is also proved to be a valuable tool in studying the structural and dynamic features of polymer dynamics, cytoskeletal polymers that act in filaments, microfilaments, and microtubules. And it also provides a platform for super resolution microscopy imaging. So in a previous talk, Andres talked about temporal resolution, what is that we can achieve in state-of-the-art techniques. I would like to focus here on spatial resolution, what you can achieve with this special technique. So to give a brief overview of my talk, first of all, I would like to show some introductory examples to highlight what's the difference between the classical epi-illumination and TURF illumination. And I would like to just briefly summarize the issue of resolution in light microscope and explain why this technique is related to that. Briefly go through the origin of the idea to use this phenomenon of total internal reflection in light microscopy. Explain physical principles and technical considerations, what you need to upgrade a fluorescence microscope to a TURF microscope, and I would close this kind of technical session section of my talk with a slide that highlights what you can do and what you cannot do with the technique. And in the second part of my talk, I would like to show you some selected case studies related to polymer dynamics, cell biological studies, how you can play with the surface chemistry. I explain that it will be important. And I will briefly touch how TURF microscopy can be used in single molecular localization applications. Okay. So this is my first introductory example. Here we have a cell, two different proteins are labeled by different fluorophores, the VGFP, that's myosin, if you are familiar with that, and the red fluorescent protein is coupled to actin. So this is what you can see when you illuminate your cell with a traditional or conventional epi illumination. So in this case, the light simply goes through the sample perpendicular to the cavity. It illuminates throughout the entire sample. So that's the emission, what you get. But here you can really identify where your cell is, but what are the intracellular resolve some fine details, fine localization details about your proteins. So it seems that with TERFs you can get more details, and then it seems that with TERFs you can improve the resolution. My second example is related to my own research. So my research group is interested in studying cytoskeletal polymers, actin filaments, and microtubules, their dynamics and interactions with associated proteins. So we purify actin from muscle tissue, so it's a completely cell-free system. We induce the assembly of actin to form fiber-like structures labeled by fluorophore. And then we put this sample in the microscope, and we again use the classical epi illumination, and this is what we can get. So if you inspect this image, you may notice some structures, some brighter regions than the background. So you can say that there is something in the sample, but you do not really have any kind of quantitative or qualitative data just by looking at this image. Now if you switch to TERF, you again by selectively illuminating the plane which is close to the blood surface, you are able to recognize individual actin filaments. These are these bright fiber-like structures. So since you see them individually, you can quantify them individually. I will give you more examples on particularly on this this field of application. So again, it seems that you can resolve more details with TERF microscopy, and again, it seems that you improved your resolution. And indeed, actually, the use of total internal reflection in light microscopy was one of the first ideas behind what we call today super resolution imaging. Okay, so I mentioned the resolution limit, and just to briefly summarize this concept. So the image formation in a light microscope or fluorescence microscope is determined by physical laws, geometrical and wave optics principles. And the resolution, how small things you can distinguish in a light or fluorescence microscope, is inherently limited by the wave nature of light. So if, in a simpler situation, if you imagine that you have a point-like object, this is an infinitely small thing, that you want to image this point-like object, when you do so, what you get is not a concise point on your image, but you will get a three-dimensional structure that's an interference pattern shown here. It has different shapes in the lateral direction as the XY plane that is parallel to the cover slip. And also it has this elliptical shape in the axial direction, Z direction, which is perpendicular to the cover slip. And due to this phenomenon that was realized quite early, the smallest things that you can distinguish on an image are separated by a few hundreds of nanometers. So in the lateral direction, it's something like 200 nanometers that you can get the best, and the axial direction, it's a little bit worse, and the resolution is a little bit worse, it's approximately 800 nanometers. So this was bottleneck. This is a physical principle, so we cannot escape this physical principle. This was a bottleneck of the fluorescence microscopy for quite a long time, and inspired scientists to find out tricks and ideas how we can kind of escape this constraint and improve the resolution, and that emission microscopy, the STED that uses the stimulated emission depletion of fluorescence. It's a kind of point spread engineering technique. Another super resolution imaging technique is the single molecular localization microscopy technique. Andres already mentioned this special fluorophores that can be switched on and off. So these techniques uses these phototransformable fluorophores to be able to identify the exact position by doing some mathematics. And the last one is the structured illumination microscopy, the SIM, that uses a grid and illuminates the sample through this grid, which rotates. And by using this trick, we can extend the frequency space to higher frequencies, and thereby we can resolve smaller things on the image, approximately to 100 nanometers that we can get. I highlighted here that, in 2014, some of the physical principles and chemical principles of these techniques were awarded by the Nobel Prize related to the stimulation emission depletion microscopy, and also the development of the phototransformable fluorophores that really opened up a new era to develop super resolution imaging techniques, were awarded by the Nobel Prize. Okay. Yeah, so the historical perspectives, the use of total integral reflection is relatively early, and it is credited to E.G. Ambrose. Ambrose was interested in studying cell surface and cell extracellular matrix contacts. He used the conventional light microscope, so no fluorescence here, and he realized that, according to cite him, it's possible to make use of the slight penetration of light waves into the less dense medium when totally internally reflected. So he could specifically visualize the boundary of the cell near the surface. The idea of, or the principle of total internal reflection was coupled by fluorescence microscopy by Daniel Axelrod. And that is actually the first publication that describes the physical principles of how this technique can be implemented into a fluorescence microscope. Okay, so let's look at the physical principles of turf microscopy. So to understand the physical principles of turf microscopy, we need to recall some basic geometrical optics considerations. Let's assume that you want to image a cell. The cell is on a cover slip, so it is attached to a glass surface, and the cell is in an aqueous medium. So if you compare the refractive indices, the glass has a larger refractive index as compared to the aqueous medium in which your cells are. So if you shine light on your sample and you use the classical epi illumination, it's perpendicular to the glass surface, so it will pass through the sample without any change in direction. Now you start to change the angle of incidence of your excitation beam. And since the refractive index of the sample here, that's the second medium, is lower than the refractive index of the glass, that's the first medium, your angle of refraction will be larger than the angle of incidence. So if you further increase your angle of incidence, then you reach a situation in which the refractive beam is parallel to the surface. And that's the corresponding angle is the critical angle. If you increase even more the angle of incidence above the critical angle, this is the supercritical regime, what you will see from this relatively simple, considering this relatively simple physical principles, that the light is reflected back from the surface. That's what we call total internal reflection. And you may say that it's reflected back from the surface, so nothing will enter into the second medium with your cell suspension. Okay. Just one note here, there is a relatively how to derive the critical angle. It will be important for the third setup later on, how to derive the critical angle. So you need to know the refractive indices of the two media, and then using this simple formula, you can find out what is the critical angle that you should use to have the third illumination. Okay, so this is how we are so far. To extend our understanding of the physical principles of total internal reflection fluorescence microscopy, we also need to consider many of these principles. I don't want to go deeply into the math, I just put these equations here to justify that by using physical principles and doing a little bit of math, you can prove what I'm gonna explain here. So actually, if we consider the Maxwell's equations, the solution of these equations proves that upon total internal reflection, we do get a field right above the surface in the second medium that decays exponentially. And that is, so since it fades away from the surface, but disappears in space from the surface, this is why we call it an evanescent. So we do get an evanescent field in the second medium upon total internal reflection. The intensity profile of this evanescent wave can be derived. So that's the formula here. You can see that decays exponentially. I0 is the intensity at the surface, at the boundary of the two media. Z is the distance, the perpendicular distance from the surface. And this D is what we call the penetration depth. Sometimes it's called the decay length. Which depends on the refractive indices, the wavelength, and the wavelength that you use for illumination. Okay, so if you look at the intensity, well, let's assume that this is an intensity profile of the evanescent wave, evanescent field that you use to illuminate your sample. One important thing, as I mentioned, that it fades away quite quickly from the surface. So if you look at these numbers, these are a few hundreds of nanometers. So it fades away within a few hundreds of nanometer from the surface. This D is the penetration depth, is the depth where the original intensity decays to its 37%. That's the physical principles, graphs and equations. Let's look at what's the consequence of using the evanescent field illumination. So here I compare the, you have seen the excitation profile on the previous slide, and now let's see the emission profile, what we can get. So here I compare the epi and the turf illumination. My sample is the same what I introduced already, so these are fluorescently labeled active filaments. And we recorded this movie on an angle course Heidelberg last year. So first we start with the epi illumination. And again, you can see that there is something in the sample, but you do not clearly see what's in the sample. So this is what we can see in turf in epi illumination. Then you switch. Switch here. This is the critical angle when the laser beam reaches the sample at the critical angle. So you have the refractive beam which is parallel to the surface. You get already an improvement in resolution and reduction in the background noise, and that is what you get at the end when you switch to a turf illumination. The contrast is not that good at the end because this is a single movie, so you need to adjust the contrast in a way that everything is visible both at the beginning and at the end. But here you see some selective images. Okay. So that will be the difference between the emission profile of sample, so you illuminate through your sample. All your fluorophores are excited in the entire thickness of your sample, so you will get the fluorescence emission from all the fluorophores which are in the sample. When you are in the critical regime, then you have this transmitted ray which is perpendicular to the surface, so a shallow region is illuminated in your sample as highlighted here, and you excite only these fluorophores, so you get the fluorescence emission from all of these fluorophores from this shallow region. And finally, when you are in the third illumination mode, you will illuminate only a tiny portion of the sample. The thickness is a few hundreds of nanometers, so if you will excite these fluorophores, you will get an emission from these fluorophores. Another thing that can be noted here, that due to this this profile, this exponentially decaying profile, the fluorophores which are closer to the surface are brighter as compared to the fluorophores which are farther apart from the surface. Those are dimmer. So if you are just looking at fluorophores on the basis of the brightness, you can have an idea which fluorophore is closer or farther from the surface. And I have time at the end, cell biology application, I'm going to show you, actually it will be important to track the intensity changes of certain vesicles. So I have to continue with some technical considerations. So what is the critical angle that we need to consider if we want to use this technique to investigate biological samples? Well, the refractive index of the glass is 1.5 approximately, and the refractive index of an aqueous medium is 1.3. And from that, based on the equation I already showed you, you can find out that the critical angle, what you need for biological samples, is about 60 degrees. Okay? The critical angle here is plotted as the refractive index ratio, just to highlight that if the refractive index of the two media, like the glass and the aqueous medium of the glass, the surface and your sample, is close to each other, then this ratio is close to 1, that corresponds to relatively high critical angles, close to 90 degrees, and if the difference is larger, then the critical angle will be smaller. Later on I will explain some technical issues, how you can reach the critical angle, and hopefully at that point you will appreciate that it's really a matter how large critical angles you want to set, because you cannot go infinitely here. But for biological samples we are in this region, 0.8, 0.9, that corresponds to 60 and 70 degrees of critical angles. The second thing, what influences the evanescent nature of this field, first of all, the angle of incidence. So here, if what is highlighted here, that if you increase your angle of incidence, you decrease the decay length. So the penetration of the evanescent field into the sample will be shallower. It will be important in terms of resolution. So if you want to have a better resolution, you want to use larger angle of incidences. The other thing which is highlighted on this figure is that if you use different wavelengths for the illumination, so the lowest goes here, and the largest wavelength is the darkest red. Again, you can improve the resolution. So the wavelength affects the penetration depth. So the lower the wavelength, the lower the penetration depth. So you can have an improvement in resolution by changing the wavelength, but that was already explained by the classical theory of the resolution limit. So the importance of the angle of incidence in the resolution. Again, why I highlighted this thing want to set the same penetration depth, because otherwise the two things, what you see colocalized on an image, will not be colocalized, because simply just the penetration depth, what you illuminate in your sample, is different. The another technical issue, or what influences the evanescent nature of this field, the refractive index of the sample. You can imagine that you can have a refractive index in homogeneities in your sample. So you have a cell, sometimes it's thicker, sometimes it's thinner, so the refractive index can change along the cell. And if you change the refractive index, if you have a refractive index in homogeneity in your sample, that can influence the penetration depth of the evanescent field. To minimize this effect, what you can do is to increase the critical angle. So at low critical angles, for example, maybe let's look at this curve here, around 70 degrees you have this dependence of the decay length on the refractive index in homogeneity per sample. So even if small, even small changes in the refractive index results in large changes in the decay length. While if you use a larger critical angle here, relatively large changes in the refractive index of your sample, the inhomogeneity in your sample results only in a modest change in the decay length or the penetration depth of the evanescent field. Okay, and now let's see how you can set up a fluorescence microscope to a turf microscope. So you can find commercially available solutions from all the large microscopy companies. This is the system that we have in page. This is an all-in-use system based on an ISA4 stand. What is needed? So you use So for the illumination, most you can use lamp illumination for the turf microscopy, but most of the systems use laser illumination. So you will need lasers for the illumination. You need also some optics to couple these lasers into the microscope to adjust the position of the beam and also to focus the laser beams. A special component is an objective, so you need a special objective that is dedicated for turf microscopy, which is compatible with turf illumination. I will give more details on that a little bit later. But otherwise, you can use any of the optical components of the system that is used for conventional fluorescence microscopy imaging. Okay, so what you need to consider to implement the total internal reflection principles into the fluorescence microscope, two things: the refractive index ratio of the sample and the boundary. And since if you consider biological samples, we usually use a glass, a cover glass, and the sample is an aqueous sample. So usually it is fulfilled that the refractive index of the sample is smaller than the refractive index of the glass or the surface on which the sample is. The second thing is that you need to reach the critical angle of illumination to be able to have total internal reflection, and as a consequence the evanescent mode of illumination. I already showed you these numbers. So for biological samples, it's about 60 degree critical angle. And I would like to spend more time on this because critical angle is a critical issue in turf microscopy. Yeah, that's just the checklist. To sum up, as I mentioned, you can use a lamp as a light source, but most, if not all, these systems are based on the use of lasers. You will need a special objective that is capable of refraction of the laser light on the prism, the critical angle could have been reached. So in a simple setup, you have this laser beam here, and then you use mirrors to direct the laser beam. So it's directed in a vase. You can move this mirror up and down. You can direct the laser beam in a way that when it goes through the prism, it reaches the sample angles which are larger than the critical angles, so the total internal reflection can occur. In case of the objective based illumination, you have an objective here, for example, you have the laser beam. To reach the critical angle, you change the position of the laser beam. So you just considering the optical axis of the whole system, you shift out the path of the laser beam from the optical axis of the system, and you can do it manually by using a micrometer, or in most commercially available setups, you can do it via the software. So this is an example, the panel in the software that we have. So you can adjust the position of the laser beam as you wish, or you can define the penetration depth, what you want to reach, and then the position is adjusted accordingly. You can also set the critical angle if you wish to enter that parameter, and you can also change the refractive index of sample or the immersion media that you use to be able to properly set that. The two important things that the laser beam needs to be in an off-axis position as compared to the optical axis of the objective that is shown schematically here. So if it goes along the optical axis when it enters into your sample, it will not change its direction, so you are not able to reach the total internal reflection. So to be able to reach these steep angles corresponding to the supercritical regime, what you do, you physically move out the laser beam towards the edges of the objective. So in case of turf illumination, the laser beam goes here, and when it converges from the objective, it converges at steep angles which are larger than the critical angles. The second thing is that the laser beam has to be focused into the back focal plane of the objective, because if you do so, then all the rays, so the rays are collimated, all the rays are parallel, so all the rays leave the objective at the same angle, and actually this is what you want to have. You want to have all the rays to be at the critical angle, or angles larger than the critical angle, but in any case it's the same angle. Okay. So as I mentioned, the objective is a key part of the curve system. We already saw that the critical angles for biological samples are above 60 degrees. And if you translate this angle to the numerical aperture, what you need in terms of numerical aperture, just by doing a simple calculation, you get this 1.38. So the numerical aperture, let's say, must be larger than 1.4. And that is that was a strong limitation for turf microscopy to have these really large numerical aperture objectives. This table just summarizes what you can have as commercially available objectives. So you can have this 1.4, 1.45, 49, and this special one is a 1.65 numerical aperture objective, works with special cover glasses and special immersion medium, which I guess costs a lot. The objective is already, I guess, costs 1.4 as the numerical aperture. So the portion of the objective that you can use for turf illumination is the excess about this 1.4. This is, I try to schematically represent here. So this is a 1.4 objective. Previously I calculated 1.38. So this central disk is the minimum numerical aperture that you need for turf illumination of all figures. And the darker red disk behind is the available numerical aperture. So if you have a low numerical aperture objective, you can use only this portion, this tiny portion of the objective, to set up the turf illumination. If you have a larger numerical aperture objective, it's 1.45, you have a larger portion, which already works well, and for this extreme 1.65, you have an even larger portion of the objective that can be utilized for turf illumination. Okay? So why is it important? I just show the cross-section of the objective on these two figures here. So you need to reach angles larger than the critical angles, something like 60 degrees. To set up those angles, you shift the laser beam